When I did a video about this Philips FC931 cassette deck, a few people said they could hear some flutter in the recording test I did. And I did too. Even though this was a new old stock, never opened or used item that had been sitting in its original box from 1994 until when I bought it in 2020. And even though the belts were good enough to allow it to work, all the playback and recording functions worked, it could still need new belts because they've been sitting in the same position for 26 years. And when you do that to a belt, it goes oval-shaped. And sometimes once you start using the item again, eventually it'll work itself out and it'll sound good again. I've noticed that myself with turntables. If I don't use them for a year or two and I start using them again, I could hear the speed variance. But after I play them a while, they sound fine. But in this case, I've used this deck for at least a couple hours on both sides, and it wasn't really getting any better, so I decided it was time to replace the belts. Luckily enough, I found a belt kit for it on eBay, and appropriately enough, for a cassette deck that was built in Portugal, it was from a seller in Portugal called Web Spare Parts. This cost about $16. There's only one belt in each deck, so there's only two belts total for the entire machine, which makes it a little more convenient to replace in some decks. I know I could have taken off the old belts and measured them and just get generic replacements, but since a belt kit was available for it, I decided to use it. It just makes life easier. Especially if you get one of these that the original belts have degraded to such an extent that you can't even measure them because they've completely gone to goo, as what sometimes happens. That's when a belt kit really comes in handy. While I was waiting for these new belts to come in, what I did is I practiced. I took this apart, and on this side, I took the original belt off, flipped it around, I flipped it inside out, and put it back on, and it did seem to reduce the flutter. With my test tape, it's now within the original manufacturer spec. So I'm going to keep the original belt in this deck for now. I'll keep one of these as a spare. But I will replace the belt in this side because it's the recording side, it's more important, and I really want to put a new belt in it. A service manual for this and many other cassette decks is available online, and you would think that would help you, but I've actually never seen a service manual for a cassette deck that gives step-by-step instructions on how to replace the belts. Like I said in my video about a Panasonic cassette deck a couple months ago, they probably just figured the belts would last for the service life of the machine. They never thought people would still be playing cassettes 25 or 30 years later. To replace the belts on this deck, of course, first you have to remove the top cover, which is usually pretty straightforward. Although in this case, like I mentioned in my initial review of it, it uses Torx screws instead of Phillips screws, which is ironic because it was made by Phillips. And yes, I know Phillips that made this is not the same as the Phillips that made the screwdrivers. Anyway, to make life easier, even though there is some clearance to remove the cassette deck mechanism from behind, it makes life a lot easier to remove the front panel. And to do that, there are just four more Torx screws here to remove. Then you can carefully pull off the front panel ever so slightly like that. And then, let me see. I may have to undo this ground wire because that's sort of retaining it, which again is a Torx screw. That's almost sort of captive in there, so I might as well just leave it. Okay, now can I... And you also have to be careful, the power button is on a stick here, which sticks out through the front panel, so you have to kind of guide that away from the front panel without breaking that stick. And now I can carefully flip this over like that, and now I can remove this mechanism to replace the belts. First you want to remove the wires and cables going to it. So this big one here is the first one. Gotta be careful, don't bend these pins. Okay, and then everything else just unplugs. Let me see, is that Okay, that one goes to the other deck, so I don't need to remove that, but I need to remove this little one. Let's see. I think I need to remove this. Even though it's not connected to the mechanism, it's going to be in the way. Oh, and there's one more ground wire I need to unscrew here. And I think we're basically ready to unscrew the mechanism and remove it. Just more Torx screws. Oh, you have to eject the door. Give you clearance to remove the mechanism, and now we're home free. This is somewhat similar to some Sony mechanisms I've seen, that it's a clamshell. You have to take off the top part and open it up, and that gives you access to the belts in the middle. So it kind of sandwiches the belts between two halves of the mechanism. And to do that, you take off these two nuts here, and then there's one small Phillips screw there, and you can hinge this up to gain access to the belts. You notice, to help you put the belt back on, there's these two hooks here. You hook the belt onto the plastic pegs, you close the sandwich back together of the top and bottom parts, and then you, using a hook tool, you move the belt from these pegs to the motor pulley. But one thing you have to be careful with are these solenoids. There's very fine wires going to these solenoids, and when you bend this part up, you have to make sure you don't rip off those wires. I noticed that when I was doing the other one, I saw those wires and I was a little concerned about that. My tools for this part of the job are the aforementioned hook, a small Phillips, or in this case JIS screwdriver. This is a 3/16 inch nut driver, which I'm sure is not the correct size. It's probably just some close metric equivalent, but this works, so I'll use it. And to help me lift up the upper half of the clamshell to allow me to replace the belt without lifting it too far and possibly tearing off those fine wires, I have this helping hands tool I'm going to use to clamp it into place so I can work on it without fear of breaking off those wires. So first, those two nuts. Where'd it go? It's still in there. Okay, got it out. Now that little Phillips screw down here. Just carefully dump that out. Okay, now we're ready to take apart this clamshell and replace that belt. Here we go. Should just lift apart. Oh, I may have to cut that wire tie because it's tying the wires to the upper half, so I'm gonna cut that wire tie. So at least on this deck, you could probably tell if the belts have ever been replaced. If this wire tie is missing, it's a good sign the belts were already changed at some point. Carefully lift that up. It's about as all we need to get to those belts, so I'll just clamp that into place. You see the belt already coming off. Okay, that's the original belt. And yes, you can see it has kind of gone oval shaped. You can see there's a kink there where it was wrapped around the motor pulley for 26 years. So definitely good to replace it. there was no way I was going to be able to do this with the camera in the way when I was working on it, but you can see I wrapped the belt around that pulley there, and then it hooks onto those two pegs and sort of rests on the top of this pulley here. And then once we close it back up, the belt's going to be taken off those two pegs and hooked onto the motor pulley. Okay, I was able to get that clamshell back together. Two things you got to watch out for: make sure this metal post is within that slot. There's another metal post back there. It just rests on the back of it. And I did not break off any of those small wires, luckily, although one of them did come unglued. So that's just the one thing you really have to be careful with. So now I just have to put those two bolts back on, that one Phillips screw. I realize I'm not showing everything here, but this is the kind of thing where you just have to have some mechanical intuition and experience of taking things apart and putting them back together. So before you do this on a deck you care about, practice on a cheap cassette deck you don't care about. Take it apart, try to put it back together, and try not to break it in the process. And once you get the hang of that, then you can work on something you actually do care about. And there is the belt, which we need to unhook from those two pegs and hook onto the motor pulley right on top of it. Okay, I was able to do that fairly easily, although it's rather crooked on these pulleys.
Somewhat straight.
Hopefully once we turn this on and it starts spinning, it'll straighten the belt out, or else it'll just pop off the pulley and we'll need to do this all over again. Anyway, it's all back together, just need to reinstall it in the machine. So I reinstalled the mechanism, reconnected the wires, and I just have to carefully put the front panel back into place. And again, you just have to be careful to get this power button to stick through the hole in the front panel. And I don't have this screwed into place, so it's a little bit wobbly, but I'll turn it on. Okay, nothing so far. Bring our tape. First, try fast forward. Okay, that's working. Rewind. Working. Play. That's working. Change side. Working. Okay, I think we're good to go here. So there's the old belt and there's the new belt, and you can see that even though the old one is still fully intact, it's definitely stretched out and gone egg-shaped. So that's why it was a good idea to replace it.
Tapes.
So that's my non-step-by-step tutorial on how to replace the belts on this Philips FC931 cassette deck. I would consider this to be moderately difficult to replace the belts because it's not nearly as easy as the decks that use the tanishin mechanism, but it's not nearly as difficult as many others I've seen, especially since it only uses one belt per deck. And for my test of the new belt, I'll be using Slugbug's Pointless Journey album, which has recently been re-released on cassette. This time duplicated in real time on Nakamichi decks. Standard Type 1 tape, no Dolby, but it sounds very good.
Do anything.
There was no need for new ideas. Some of us.